First, my respects and admiration to Pastor Dahlberg for the work that you're doing here. So thank you. And to be in this incredibly beautiful church and with these two very accomplished and distinguished people, I'm really happy to be here and have the opportunity to talk about something that has just become so much a big part of my life. I like to always start with just a little bit about my past, because I think it informs the work that I do today. With my own father being born and raised in Hungary and going through very tumultuous times after World War I, losing his father to World War I, the Nazis, the Russians, and everything that happened during that time period, my father had to flee Hungary like many, many thousands of people. He fled to Austria, and he told me this story, which he rarely talked about any of this stuff. He was very, very quiet about it, as many Europeans are. And he was incarcerated in Austria, and he climbed out of the window of the police station and fled. So he broke the law, and he went, eventually ended up in a refugee camp as a displaced person, where he lived for 2 years. And eventually he was allowed to leave and go to Venezuela, where he became a naturalized Venezuelan citizen, learned Spanish. And then he met my mom in Mexico, and they got married and came here to Ohio. And they moved to the Hungarian part of Cleveland in the Buckeye neighborhood. My oldest brother was actually born in Mexico, and I would have been born there, but they decided to come up here because we had a lot of people from the Mexican side of our family working in Ohio in the steel mills and in the Akron-Canton area, which is where I was born. So I've always been around immigrants, the stories, the different languages, the accents. As a kid, I grew up seeing the discrimination my parents faced. My dad had a very, very thick Hungarian accent, and John's heard me tell this story a thousand times because we've done so many panels together. But my dad spoke Spanish with a Hungarian accent. And so that's how we grew up. And I was always aware of things. And in Ohio is an agricultural state. That is one of the top 10 industries in the world, is not just farming and the farmers, the crops, but also hog farms, horse farms, and so forth, the chicken farms. And who works at all these places? Picking the radishes, working in the nurseries, for example, in Lake County, the parsley, the butternut squash. I've seen it all, the blueberries, the cucumbers, the little mini ones. Those are picked by immigrant hands. The people who are working in the egg farms, in the dairy farms, those are immigrants. Many who are undocumented. And this is a $6 billion industry. The nurseries alone generate $90 million a year in just Lake County alone. And who works there with a shovel, day in and day out, are immigrants, many of whom are undocumented, and it's just been that way. I don't know why, but that's how it is all over the country, from California's Central Valley, where there's thousands of undocumented immigrants working the fields. You've heard the song, Woody Guthrie's Deportee. In 1949, nothing has changed. It's very similar today, almost exactly the same today. The Eastern Shore of Virginia, tomatoes in Florida, 100,000 immigrant workers picking tobacco in the Carolinas. I've been to those fields, I've seen the labor camps, I've worked in those labor camps. And so here in Northeast Ohio, where I ended up with my parents, I began working with the farm workers in the nurseries. And I started to learn how this regime, as John says, has been created, a big, huge deportation machine that's full of trip wires made to make the lives of these immigrants so difficult. And the question I get all the time is, well, why don't they just become legal? It's because there is no way to become legal once you're here undocumented, unless you marry a U.S. citizen. So all of the problems that a impoverished community, a marginalized community would face is exacerbated by their immigration status. And so that's why you hear people say they're living in the shadows. And what Ola's work has been really focused on has been to empower this community, to bring them out of the shadows and use their own voices and their own actions to improve their lives. So I try to teach the community to stand up, speak out, defend yourselves, defend your families. Because I don't think it's fair that you're packaging apples down in Willard, Ohio for 16 hours a day, and you've been doing it for over a decade, 7 days a week. And the only day you can get out is on a Sunday. So you go to Walmart with your little boy, who is a U.S. citizen, at 10 o'clock at night, and you get pulled over by the police, and they ask you your legal status. And you say, well, I'm not legal. Okay, we're calling the Border Patrol. And off you go to the multi-million dollar Border Patrol facility in Port Clinton, Ohio, which, as you know, there's no bridge into Canada there. So why is there a Border Patrol facility there? It's to do interior operations in all of the farms and that whole, what they call Ohio's breadbasket. And it's a type of harassment. So you end up in the Border Patrol, and the little boy spends the night in the jail. He's only 8 years old, and he's a U.S. citizen, but he's already spending the night in jail. And freezing cold, she gets put in deportation, and their lives get completely destroyed. And this is repeated day after day after day. Countless families getting torn apart, destroyed, turned on the TV. What's the problem? It's the immigrants. They're the problem. They're the ones ruining this country. And I look at myself and say, where is this coming from? When I look at the community that I serve, I see people with a strong work ethic, just digging with that shovel, day in and day out, filling borders, packaging those apples, putting the tomatoes in the buckets and hopping from plant to plant. I don't know where the source of the scorn and hatred comes. Because maybe they say, well, they're taking over our country. I don't see that. They don't want to learn English. Yes, they do. It's proven. My parents did not speak, I'm a perfect example right here. My parents came here, did not speak a word of English. I did not speak English when I started kindergarten. I'm speaking English now. And likewise, the people that I work with, their kids, they don't even want to eat a tamale. They want pizza with jalapenos on it. They just try to separate themselves. That is the power of American culture. They're listening to American music. So I'm not exactly quite sure, but I wish it wasn't that way. I wish we could retain the culture. I've been to some of the other churches here in Cleveland, the ethnic churches. If you go to St. Casimir's, the Polish church on the east side, they do the mass in Polish. And the people in the congregation speak Polish. And I think that's a beautiful thing. I love it. I don't want that to go away. And I think we should celebrate the diversity in this country. But unfortunately, we're in very difficult times right now. I could go into the things that I'm seeing, but in 10 minutes, there's not enough time to talk about the detention centers that are proliferating all over Ohio, the wall that's going to be built to make it look like we're in one big detention center here in the United States. It's going to be one big detention center. And we're all trapped in it. Because that's where this country is heading. The paperwork, the bonds that the judges set, the individual gets picked up, let's say a farm worker out in Norwalk, gets out on a bond, if he can come up with $20,000 cash in 2 weeks. Now, do you know how much money you make when you're picking tomatoes? You get 40 cents for a 32-pound bucket. How are you supposed to pay a $20,000 bond? But the people collect in the community, they try. Most people can't make it, and they get deported. Some people can, and they'll still get deported. So all of these policies that are coming out of the rhetoric and the inciting of the hatred towards this community has Ola here to help push back, defend our families, defend our community, and protect our families. So that's really what the goal is of Ola. And we do it in many different ways. We also work to help integrate our community through all kinds of programs and things. But we're very grassroots, and I welcome any questions. So I know this is kind of a generalized overview, but you to hear where I'm coming from.